morning, which will continue tomorrow from 9 a.m. in the morning, on History Through Photographs, Exploring the Visual Landscape of Northeast India, Dr. Jai Pachwal and Professor William Van Schendel. Tomorrow evening at 5 o'clock in this room, we have a public lecture in the Rethinking History series by Professor Rustam Bharucha of JNU, Between History and Performance, Reflections on the Limits of Discipline. On Monday, which is the 4th of November, at 3 o'clock, there's a seminar by Dr. Soumyabrata Chowdhury of the Center for Studies in Social Sciences, Kolkata, Refusing the Feminine Position During the French Revolution and Not Telling the Story of, my pronunciation is unsure, Theroine de Mericourt, a feminist historical critique of medical sovereignty. And on the 5th in the regular weekly seminar, Dr. Ranjita Datta of Jamia Millia will speak on saints and sinners, the Sri Vaishnava community and networks of control in the early medieval period. There are some new papers which have come out. I'll just announce them. You can get them outside and they're also on our website, freely downloadable. Kathleen Morrison in the History and Society series, The Human Face of the Land, Why the Past Matters for India's Environmental Future, and Geeta Dharampal Frick, Integrating the Historical Discourse on Caste and Race in India. We also have some in the other series, Perspectives in Indian Development, Nitya V. Raman, Lessons from the Past for Revitalizing Planning Practice in India, and Vrunda Pathare, Business Archives, A Window into the Corporate Past. Also, Kalyani Devaki Menon, Prayer and Power in the Sangh Parivar. With these words, I'll hand over to Mr. Singh.
Thank you, Mahesh. First, I don't know whether I'm supposed to do this on behalf of Nehru Memorial. Let me welcome Professor Nivedita Menon, who will speak on the university transformation and the work of intellect. Now, that's on behalf of the Nehru Memorial. And on my own personal behalf, let me say that I am most thrilled. This is the first time I'm sitting to the right of Nivedita and having to hear her from a different kind of vantage point. But if I were to translate this kind of a large theme in my own language, I think we are all very interested in what is happening to our worlds of knowledge production, knowledge reproduction, knowledge distribution, communication, etc., etc. We are all worried about the new kind of shape that our colleges and universities are taking, the nature of relationship between teaching institutions and research institutions, both within and without, their link with both state and corporates, and in general, how we perceive the world of knowledge. These are crucial questions, not only to those who directly participate in these ventures, which are people like you, who are active researchers, teachers, etc. But they're hugely important even to those of us outside who are consumers of the kind of work that you people do, the ideas that you put out. And these have major reflections on the way our society values those involved in these exercises and in these productions, etc., etc. And I think that they have much to do with the nature of our collective self-confidence, what we are willing to support, in what kind of circumstances. Professor Menon, whom I've known for a long period of time, has been actively engaged as an undergraduate teacher, as a postgraduate teacher, as a researcher, as a debater in terms of public issues, and therefore is uniquely positioned to tell us something about these things. And I think that all of us would both be extremely interested and then join her in terms of the nature of propositions that she advances. Nivi.
Thank you, Harsh. I want to begin by thanking Mahesh and Nehru Memorial Museum and Library for the opportunity to share some thoughts that I'm in the process of exploring around questions of knowledge, education, and pedagogy. So that's also the first caveat, which is that this paper is actually in the nature of a space-clearing exercise, really, rather than a finished product. And the second caveat is that I am actually not going to enter what has in fact become a very productive and dense field of debates on policy in India around higher education. There's a there's a lot of work there. That is not the area that I'm going to touch upon except tangentially, because the focus of my paper is elsewhere. So I'm going to think about questions such as what counts as knowledge, what is the relationship between knowledge and values, how is knowledge to be transmitted, is the process of transmitting knowledge education, and is the university in its present form the appropriate vehicle for this transmission? So these are some of the questions that I started with, and in this presentation I actually reflect on a field of substantial scholarship that has been produced around these questions in various ways, hoping to engage old questions in new ways through this engagement. So I would begin with the question, what counts as knowledge and how is it to be transmitted, and certain kinds of debates around that. I would begin with Jacques Rancière's The Ignorant Schoolmaster, in which Rancière writes about Joseph Jacotot. Many of you may be familiar with this text, and it has been widely discussed as a text about radical pedagogy, but I'm in fact going to suggest that there is a serious problem with the way in which Rancière conceptualizes knowledge in this text, and from there I will go on hopefully to outline some other more subversive positions. So Joseph Jacotot slash Rancière, because it's understood that Rancière is making a certain argument about knowledge through the figure of Jacotot, who's a historical figure. So he writes about Joseph Jacotot, a school teacher driven into exile during the period of monarchical restoration in France in the early 19th century, who developed a method of showing illiterate parents how they could themselves teach their children to read. Landing up with a job in a Flemish-speaking part of Belgium, he had to teach children who spoke no French while he spoke no Flemish. He tried an experiment with a recently published bilingual edition of Homer. Please forgive me if you're familiar with this part of Jacotot's work, because I know this work is very well known, but nevertheless I do need to trace these steps. So what he did was he faced with the students who spoke no French while he spoke no Flemish, he tried an experiment with a recently published bilingual edition of Homer in French and Flemish. What he did was he asked his students through an interpreter to learn on their own the French text with the help of the Flemish translation. After some time, he asked them to write about the text in French, and he was astonished to find that they could do so as well as French students would have done. He had not taught them the first elements of French, neither spelling nor grammar. The students had basically looked for French words that corresponded to words that they knew in Flemish and figured out the grammar by themselves. The pedagogical problem then, and what Rancière is saying via Jacotot, is that the pedagogical problem is to reveal an intelligence to itself. Anything can be used, a song, a prayer that a student knows by heart. There is always something the student knows that can be used as a point of comparison. The master's two fundamental tasks then are interrogation, he demands speech, the manifestation of an intelligence that was not aware of itself, and verification, that the work is done with attention. To do this, a highly skilled master is not required and is even a liability, because his knowledge discreetly leads the students to the right answer, rather than allowing their own intelligence to do the work. In this method, which Jacotot then named universal teaching, equality is not a goal to be attained, but assumed as a starting point. Anyone is capable of grasping the most difficult of ideas, since the same intelligence is at work in all human endeavor. Now, at one level, clearly, this is the kind of radical pedagogy of which we can immediately see the progressive potential. But it seems to me that it addresses only one kind of knowledge and one kind of learning. That is, its radicalism lies in using one's own intelligence rather than that of a teacher to enter into an existing body of knowledge with its own established rules, to learn how to do X. But what if one thinks of knowledges as having to be subverted, of existing knowledges as embodying dominant discourses of power, of knowledges as constituting subjects of governmentality, in Foucault's terms? Then the point would not be to learn the rules well, but to support them, to constitute new bodies of knowledge and count ourselves. For instance, Rancière does not consider the politics of the gradual marginalization of Flemish by the French nation state in the making, so that it would always be Flemish speakers having to learn French, rather than the other way around. Rancière does not consider the ways in which modernity in general introduced standardized forms of organizing time and space, maps, calendars, that did considerable violence to the present knowledges it was still replacing in Jacques Cousteau's time. Thus, Rancière says, as an example of Jacques Cousteau's kind of universal education, that, for example, a locksmith who does not know the alphabet can look at a calendar. I quote Rancière, doesn't he know the order of the months? And cannot he thus figure out January, February, March? He knows that February has only 28 days. He sees that one column is shorter than the others, and he will recognize 28, unquote. However, the Gregorian calendar that Rancière takes for granted has nothing to do with the natural cycles by which peasants live, and illiterate people have to learn to read the calendar as much as they have to learn to read the alphabet. It is not a knowledge that is inborn or naturally imbibed in all worlds and contexts, even today in the 20th century. So this way of learning appears then to be about learning how to enter and negotiate existing formations of knowledge. It's useful here to consider an argument made by Peter Winch, who, writing about the relationship between language and reality, makes a distinction between two kinds of languages. One is a set of linguistic conventions, such as English, French, or French, Flemish, and so on. When one knows one language and wants to learn another, one remains within the same world, learning English names for the objects and experiences one already knows in French. Thus, when one learns to command, say, in English, do this, one is not learning to command, per se. But the difference between the language of science modernity and those of other worldviews, Winch uses the example of the magic practices of an African tribe called the Azande, the differences between these kind of languages are not of this order. When one learns mathematics, say, or science, one learns a whole worldview, a set of beliefs, of which the language is only an expression. Learning to prove something mathematically is not simply learning a new way of expressing something I already know in another language. I am learning a new action that can only be performed in that language. The reason Jacques Cousteau's method requires no teacher or the ignorant teacher is that education is seen as learning to do in a new language what you already know in another. You don't see beyond or question the world you're given. You learn to negotiate it. The calendar can teach you numbers in the alphabet only if you're already immersed in a world marked by calendars and clocks. So mainstream education, so it seems to me that the ignorant schoolmaster vision of education is still about mainstream education. It's about schooling society, to draw on Ivan Illich's famous phrase. And his aim, Illich's aim, was to de-school society. Adapting what Illich said about school to all forms of institutionalized learning is not very difficult. Illich defined school as the age-specific, teacher-related process requiring full-time attendance at an obligatory curriculum. School and education in this sense is a modern phenomenon, and it requires the mass production of something called childhood, or in the case of higher education, studenthood. As Illich puts it, the few people around the world who have actually allowed childhood rarely enjoy playing the child's role. Only by segregating some human beings in the category of child or student could we ever get them to submit to the authority of a teacher. Schooling, then, has little to do with learning from this point of view. Illich points out that children learn their first language casually, and second or third languages are usually learned by force of circumstances. So he says they go to live with their grandparents, they travel, or they fall in love with a foreigner. Other skills are often learned on the job. A great deal of learning happens, in short, not in institutionalized centers of learning and through teachers, but as a byproduct of some other activity defined as work or leisure. Indeed, the greatest reward of human labor is the education we receive from it and the opportunity that work gives us to initiate the education of others. No wonder, says Illich, that Marx opposed the passage in the Gotha program that wanted to outlaw child labor, for he believed that the education of the young could only happen at work. Moving from here to scholar activist Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed, that too offers us a very different view of knowledge and learning than presented by Rancière. He calls it problem-posing education, and in this process, no one teaches another, but knowledge anyone self-taught. Through dialogue, the teacher of students and students of the teacher cease to exist, and the teacher-student and student-teacher emerge. They become jointly responsible for a process in which they all grow. Thus, this model too gives up on the idea of the all-knowing teacher, but not on the idea of a teacher altogether. It seems to me that the teacher in this Ferrer's understanding is the entry of the outside into one's world, destabilizing its codes of meaning, common sense, and order. In this sense, the students are the outside of the teacher's world and she of theirs. The teacher, he plays a game with the present group he is visiting, and he puts it this way: the teacher knows 10 things the students do not know, but they know 10 things that he doesn't. So they ask Ferrer 10 questions. What's soil liming? What's green fertilizer? And he asks them 10 questions. What's an intransitive verb? What's epistemology? In problem-posing education, everybody is a student teacher. People are in the process of becoming, as he puts it, unfinished beings in and with a likewise unfinished reality, thus necessitating that education be an ongoing activity, an activity that asks us to consider reality critically. We will return to this subversive understanding of education towards the end when we look at some radically alternative ways of addressing the current crisis that everybody recognizes universities have fallen into. But for now, let us go on to consider colonial pedagogy in India. Here again, I'm more interested in presenting before you a particular book, actually, Sanjay Seth's Subject Lessons, which I found to be a really sophisticated account of what colonial pedagogy does without essentializing India in any way. What is at stake in, as it emerges from Sanjay's book, what is at stake in this continuing debate is the status of modernity, the debate around education from colonial times to now, is the status of modernity itself. Now, what he does in this is he centrally questions the status of modern Western knowledge, the assumption that it is not merely one mode of knowledge, but that it is knowledge as such, and that it must be adequate to its Indian object because it is adequate to all objects. Seth places colonial education policy in India within the context of the transformations wrought by modernity itself, beginning with Europe, thus revealing both Europe and us to be particular cases of a general history of modernity, as Partha Chatterjee puts it elsewhere. In Europe, too, the advent of modernity, Seth says, had set up for the first time the knowing subject who is set apart from and set up against the objects to be known. The world became external to the knower. It became disenchanted. Now, this process of producing this new notion of knowledge decisively sidelined the pre-modern knowledges of Europe as well, when it emerged in Europe, as were the pre-modern knowledges of India. I'm using pre-modern in quotation marks because I don't see this as a teleology, but the knowledges that existed before modern Western knowledge supplanted them. So these knowledges, and Sanjay himself uses the term pre-modern, so pre-modern knowledges did not presume a sharp distinction between the knower and the world he or she sought to know. And it was precisely this understanding that came to be seen by modern knowledge as the source and root of the errors of pre-modern knowledge, this lack of distinction between the knower and the world that she sought to know is in fact the source of the errors of pre-modern knowledge from the point of view of modern knowledge. Seth points out that this was a radically new conception of knowledge and its subject had to be created through new pedagogic practices and through the transformations and disciplines enforced by industrialization and capitalism, modern armies, and the modern novel. A project that was met with resistance even in Europe, but in India further refracted by the fact of it being carried through by violent and coercive colonial rule. It should be clear that Seth's agenda is not to claim that more authentic indigenous knowledges existed and that Western education is a problem because it was alien to India. Rather, it is to situate education and pedagogy in colonial India within the framework of a modernity that has come since the 17th century to hegemonize notions of knowledge globally. So he outlines two controversies from the 19th century onwards, both of which are alive and well and kicking in the 21st century. One over the Indian student who clams, and the other over the moral crisis into which Western education has plunged the Indian, leading to inconsistent beliefs and practices. That these very issues still agitate us today in the context of education is something we need to think about very seriously. Now, what he says about cramming is very interesting. He says the controversy over cramming is over the long-standing complaint that Indian students learn by rote. As you know, CBSE recently, in an anguished fashion, has introduced open book exams to avoid this. They learn by rote, or as in the popular Indianism, they by heart their lessons. And as Shiv Vishwanathan has pointed out, that term is probably closer to it literally is by hearting, and there's something emotional about it, and perhaps it comes closer to capturing the relationship of the pre-modern self to knowledge. So the problem is they by heart, they learn by rote, rather than doing this, treating knowledge as something that is knowledge as such, separate from its application. From the perspective of the modern conception of true knowledge, as only that which is independently acquired and sustained by personal conviction, Indian students failed even when they were successful. That is, they would pass their exams after cramming, but it would be counted as a failure of education because the mastery of the task had been achieved by means that sidestepped the transformation of the subject and the relationship between subject and knowledge. And obviously this lineage of the conception of education going back to the Enlightenment is one that sections of the Indian elite had internalized, which is why we contribute equally to this lament about the tendency of Indian students to cram. The second controversy was over the failure of Western education to act as a vehicle of modernity and its simultaneous success in denationalizing its products. The complaint here was that Indian students had an instrumental relationship to knowledge, that they saw Western education as helping them to fulfill only their material needs and goals, that education did not transform them into proper modern individuals with modern values. Now, we must not misunderstand Sandhya to be suggesting that this instrumental attitude to Western knowledge is some kind of resistance to colonialism. Not at all. He rejects the idea that these dowry-seeking crammers, so that's the contradiction. They're cramming and they're fully educated, but they're dowry-seeking. So he rejects the idea that they were heroically resisting British hegemony, pointing out, in fact, that those who did seek to end colonial domination did not resist Western education, treating it as a crucial resource for the emergence of a modern nation. A.K. Ramanujan's brilliant essay, Is There an Indian Way of Thinking, just leapt into my horizon when I was reading Sanjay Seth's book, because it forces us to ask the question that Ramanujan asks. How are we to understand the fact that in the context-sensitive, that is, pre-modern Indian way of life, the context-free, that is, the modern, became simply yet another context? Ramanujan is talking of the ways in which, for example, a scientist can observe the eclipse and then go home and take a bath because he's polluted by the eclipse. So rather than seeing this as some kind of contradiction or hypocrisy, Ramanujan suggests that there's a way in which the context-free becomes one more context in India. But I think this is true for what that new formation, which we call the Global South, the new intellectual formation that we call the Global South. So the conclusion is inescapable that what is understood to be universal modernity, sweeping everything before its path, is merely a particular constellation of features specific to a small part of Europe at a particular historical moment. Sanjay makes it very clear that there was not one indigenous knowledge that confronted modern Western education, but several knowledges and practices differentiated by the intended users and the groups and castes to whom they were available and from whom they were restricted. The characteristic trait they shared, however, was that all three modern knowledges, Western and Indian, had in common, was that unlike the rationalization associated with modernity, which freed knowledge from substantive context and made it in principle independent of its uses, in traditional learning, the content and form are indistinguishable. It is only with rationalization that increasingly knowledges and skills that could only be learnt in the doing now presuppose a mastery of theory that can not only be independently learnt, but the knowledge of which is superior to merely learning by practice. Seth argues that knowledges are not forms of cognizing a world external to them, but rather are constitutive of this world. Modern knowledge then reworks the world and its past in terms comprehensible only within itself. Said correctly points out the ethical unsustainability of this position, which characterizes our contemporaries as somehow inhabiting a past that we have left behind. From his perspective, even alternative nationalist visions of education did not escape the normalizing thrust of modern Western knowledge, and that modern Western knowledge became identified with knowledge as such is, in Sanjay's words, as much the fruit of nationalist strivings as it is of colonial imposition. In the next section, I look at this idea of other knowledges as the outside of education. The next two sections will do that. In the first one, I look at the ways in which other knowledges can contribute, can be seen as destabilizing a certain kind of hegemonizing dominant worldviews. A significant document that attempts to challenge this idea of knowledge in education is the National Curriculum Framework, NCF 2005. Its focus is on school education, but as a general statement about knowledge in education, it is inspiring and creative. The NCF 2005, which I think many of us know was produced by hundreds of teachers and academics and school and college teachers and academics all over the country. The NCF 2005 holds that unless learners can locate their individual standpoints in relation to the context represented in textbooks and relate this knowledge to their experiences, knowledge is reduced to mere information. The point is that students bring with them their own experiences of the world around, which is rarely heeded. The examples the NCF cites are about, the information about local knowledges, traditions of naming and categorizing plants, or ways of harvesting and storing water, or of practicing sustainable agriculture. Sometimes these may be different from the way in which school knowledge approaches the subject, and NCF suggests that in such situations, teachers could recognize and help children develop projects of study based on the local tradition, comparing it with the school tradition. And this is how the NCF puts it. In some cases, as in the case of classifying plants, the two traditions may be simply parallel and based on different criteria considered significant. In other cases, for example, the classification and diagnosis of illnesses, it may challenge and contradict local belief systems. It is also possible to consider that there are cases where the local belief system may be more ecologically valid than the textbook opinion. Unquote. This question about the relationship between education and its outside gets inflected in a similar but somewhat different way at the level of higher education. Most syllabi in Indian universities assume the universality of theory, simply applying that theory to local specificities and thus finding large parts of the world of the global south lacking in the proper development of modern qualities such as democracy, economic development, secularism, individualism, and so on. In different ways and in different places, from Manipal in India to Kampala in Uganda, attempts are being made particularly over the last two decades, the first decades of the 21st century, to genuinely provincialize Europe and to destabilize what Shudipta Kaviraj has termed Euronormativity, asserting location as the starting point of knowledge and theorizing, drawing on intellectual traditions of the global south, making the concepts of the global south the points of reference. As Mahmud Mamdani puts it, the universalization of particular modes of thought goes alongside the particularization of other modes of thought. The centuries between the conquest of the Americas and the decolonization movement signified by Bandung witnessed two related movements in the history of thought. On the one hand, Eurocentric thought was elevated to a universal. On the other, non-European modes of thought were containerized as so many traditions of no more than local significance. An assessment of the intellectual legacy of this period calls for a double task, alongside a critique of Eurocentrism and exploration of engagement across various non-European modes of thought bounded as so many discrete traditions. This is Mahmud. The idea of applying theory produced in one context to understand practice in another assumes that political practice itself is non-theoretical, completely bereft of any discursive theoretical content, so that any theory from the West can be used to make sense of political practice anywhere. But all political practice is always constituted by some form of reflection and thought, theoretical or non-theoretical, and as we realize today, at least one part of theorization must be about making sense of practice through an understanding of the subject's own world and her categories of thought. Sundar Charukai, who set up the Manipal Center for Philosophy and Humanities recently in 2010, raises as an ethical issue the related question of privileging theory over empirically grounded work, when, in these parts of the world, narratives founded on experience are forms of theorizing, especially for the disprivileged castes, for example, through autobiography. He also states the importance of engaging with the world not only through texts and thinking, but through doing. The echoes from Sanjay's work are inescapable. That in a sense, Sundar Sarukhai and his colleagues are trying to escape that theory-practice divide that was set up by modern education, in which learning theory is considered to be more important than doing something. So he states that it's doing it, doing that knowledge. So he states the importance of engaging with the world not only through text and thinking, but through doing. He points out that science students do experiments, students of art do art and theater, but humanities students should also have to conduct their learning through the body and doing something concretely. This has to be an essential part of knowledge formation in the South. Of course, he says very honestly, how to do this and to do it effectively are questions that we have to actually begin asking. It should be clear by now that by location, I do not mean indigeneity or authenticity vis-a-vis the West. In fact, it's very little to do with the West and more to do with the modern. Rather, with the term location, I mean to gesture towards the materiality of spatial and temporal coordinates that inevitably suffuse all theorizing. A sensitivity to location would invariably lead to a productive contamination of the purity of empty universalist categories and challenge their claim to speak about everywhere from nowhere. Curricula must start with one's location in this sense, the questions about the world that puzzle you from your vantage point. A comparative dimension is inescapable. Issues in other parts of the world at one level seem familiar to those in one's own, but they get articulated in unfamiliar ways. While concerns specific to a location nevertheless resonate, echoing predicaments faced by people at some other place or in some other time. Additionally, in our parts of the world, the question of language and translation is critical. It is, after all, not just a question of translating words from one language to the other. It is about engaging with entire ways of life and modes of thinking arising from different trajectories of time and space. We also need to go beyond notions of inter- and multidisciplinarity and attempt the dismantling of disciplinary fields and their reconstitution. Interdisciplinarity still assumes basic and settled distinctions between, for example, the economic and the political, where an interdisciplinary interaction would involve taking one into account for a fuller understanding of the other. However, indisciplinarity is about occupying the interstices of settled disciplines and their consequent dismantling. Linking together the questions of location, translation, and discipline, Sundar Sarukhai puts it this way: the living local, by its very definition, cannot be bound within a strict discipline. Therefore, we need to move across ideas in different disciplines, and an interdisciplinary focus is necessarily a movement across established intellectual traditions as well, West, English, Sanskrit, vernacular, and so on. So this was about the outside, the knowledges outside the university, outside the academy, as productive and challenging to, and posing a challenge to hegemonic dominant conceptions of knowledge. But there is also another outside, which is prejudice and power. And how does one deal with that? Because the knowledges and traditions that students bring with them are not, of course, simply power-neutral languages, knowledges that students and teachers bring with them. Now, the NCF 2005, addressing it directly, says community-based identities of gender, caste, class, and religion are primary identities, but they can also be oppressive and reaffirm social inequalities and hierarchies. School knowledge can also provide a lens through which children can develop a critical understanding of their social reality. It could also provide them space to talk about their experiences and anxieties within their homes, unquote. Now, an earlier, less secular model of education in India had assumed that such beliefs can simply be eradicated. But NCF 2005 suggests a more difficult path, that communities may also have questions about the inclusion or exclusion of particular knowledge and experiences in the school curriculum. The school must then be prepared to listen to their concerns and to persuade them to see the educational value of such decisions. In other words, NCF 2005 believes the process of social transformation to be complex and multilayered, involving the student not only in the classroom, but as located in her family and community. Most importantly, this process is understood to be uncompromisingly bound within democratic procedures, listening, persuading, mutually learning. The most significant contribution of NCF 2005 is a radical rethinking of what teaching means. Currently, at every level of education, teachers are apt to think of their work as that of imparting knowledge. And I think we've all come across this phrase many, many times. Imparting knowledge, that's our job. But in the NCF 2005, teaching is understood as a process of encouraging analytical thought, debate, and engagement with the world in which learners live, with all its flaws and uncertainties. Students are to be led towards existing scholarship through a process of questioning and curiosity. But one point on which I found NCF to be silent, NCF 2005 to be silent, is that it assumes that students come with an outside, but it doesn't actually talk about teachers coming with their outside. I did say students and teachers, but that's not how the NCF doesn't address this. The teachers will necessarily carry their outside, their prejudices, their class privileges into the classroom. And we do need to recognize that the best written, most imaginatively produced textbooks and the most progressive curricula can be and are subverted by conventional, conservative, right-wing teachers. Recently in JNU, a document was produced by a committee of which I was a member, set up after the recent shocking incident in which a male undergraduate student attacked with an axe a female classmate who had been his friend. During class hours, committing suicide immediately afterwards, the woman barely survived. The incident led to widespread introspection in the JNU community, and the whole question of values carried from outside had to be addressed head-on. The report, which was an attempt to engage with this, recognized the diversity on campus across the lines of class, caste, region, religion, language, and sexual orientation, the negotiation of which requires constant dialogue and mutual respect through which outlooks on life that do not respect particular forms of diversity, for example, casteism, homophobia, communal attitude, sexism, must be transformed through participation in university life. Norms of behavioral knowledge that students and faculty carry with them, which are not in conformity with the value of equal treatment and democratic values, would have to be addressed through sensitization and so on. So, clearly, the idea is that the university stands for something, stands for some modern values, equality, personal freedom, dignity, and so on. Acceptance of diversity, but not all diversity. That is, we are not going to accept homophobia as a diverse position, and casteism and sexism. So there's clearly a sense in what kind of diversity we are willing to accept. There's also a way in which the assumption is that there is a responsibility the university has, and this is a report of which I was part, so this is it's a kind of schizophrenic look at one's own engagement in institutions like universities, that there is a sense in which the assumption is that the university should be able to address these other questions, the outside, in some way. So the struggle really is about the evident disjuncture between the knowledge that we formally provide in the university and the values carried from outside. And the evident incapacity of the routine forms of knowledge transmission to challenge these values so that you think in terms of sensitization, orientation, special courses, something has to happen outside the routine forms of knowledge transmission for these attitudes to be transformed, which should make us really wonder about routine forms of knowledge transmission. Because clearly there is some way in which routine forms of knowledge transmission talk about equal treatment, democratic values, and something else needs to be done to address the disjuncture. So it seems that the two issues that Sanjay outlined as issues for modernizing nationalists in the like 19th century in the context of what was then Western education, that is, by rote learning and the disjuncture between education and modern values, continues practically unchanged today. So should we be reconceptualizing education, knowledge, and the university altogether? When you look at, so this is the outside in two forms, in a sense, a good outside and a bad outside, and what does the university, what is university education, or what is knowledge about that cannot take into account these two outsides? In the next section, I'll very, very quickly look at some work around the Indian university in the late 20th to early 21st centuries, but where I'm again going to really focus on some very interesting things that Satish Deshpande has to say. The organization of knowledge production and transmission in universities all over the global south is based on the disciplinary model developed by Western universities over the 19th and 20th centuries. That is to say, while the earliest institutions of higher learning are found from the 5th century onwards in what is now South and West Asia, the particular form that the university took in Europe in the 19th century has come to assume the form of the only legitimate model of higher education. Of course, this was not always the case, and knowledge flowed the other way in an earlier age. So Mahmud Ramdani pointed out at a convocation address that the graduation gowns seen all over the modern world are derived from the Islamic madrasas of West Asia. The early universities of Europe, Oxford, Cambridge, Sorbonne, borrowed not just these gowns, he pointed out, but much of their curriculum from these institutions, Greek philosophy to Iranian astronomy to Arab medicine and Indian mathematics. They had little difficulty at that time in accepting this flowing gown, modeled after the dress of the desert nomad, as the symbol of higher learning, he said. There has been now considerable work on the transformations that have been sweeping higher education in India, and there was a special issue of seminar which had a number of excellent articles, and Mary John puts it in this way in her introduction. At a time when the state is supposed to be retreating, it has become feverishly active in Indian higher education, making new plans, setting up commissions and committees, putting in place a slew of bills meant to usher in an era of expansion and inclusion never witnessed before. The moment is historic. This is the first major push since independence, with higher education leveraging future growth via the development of a knowledge economy. Here I will just basically deftly sidestep this vast field of work, which in the context of the West would include an assessment of the toll that the recession has taken, the alarming growth of student debt, insecurity of tenure, and consequent exploitation of faculty and graduate students. All of this, of course, a chronicle of a debt foretold for India, for this is the model that Indian elites are aspiring to. I'm heading in a somewhat different direction, and to that end, let me note only two significant changes noted in the field of higher education in India. The most significant change visible is the size. Between 2001 and 2010, higher education more than doubled its institutions and raised enrollment by 62%, so that is from 90 lakhs to 146 lakhs. This growth, says Satish Deshpande, is driven from the demand side by a demographic growth of the young in population, expanded access to schooling, and by larger numbers being able to afford higher education, apart from, of course, the so-called OBC expansion, which actually expanded general seats as well. On the supply side, higher education has grown through privatization, with the private sector now accounting for a majority of both institutions and total enrollment. The second, no less significant change is the socioeconomic profile of those who access higher education. It used to be overwhelmingly dominated by male urban upper caste students, and even more so teachers. But women now account for 42% of total enrollment, and the so-called lower caste are also increasing their share. Hindu upper caste men, who were more than two-thirds, this is all Satish's figures, Hindu upper caste men, who were more than two-thirds of all graduates, are now minority among enrolled students, though still overrepresented relative to their population share. Rural and first-generation entrants have also been increasing. So this massive explosion in terms of size. But what is it that all these students are expecting from education? And this is where I think Satish produces and addresses a puzzle, which is around the question of quality. And the puzzling phenomenon, as he puts it, of the proliferation of institutions that do not even aspire to quality. Why, he asks, are worthless credentials not driven out of the market? Why do parents pay astronomical sums for admission of their wards into institutions known to provide little or no training? His answer is extremely insightful, very troubling, but I think it's also very productive. It's a productive kind of troubling. What he says is that it's very clear that higher education credentials in India are a claim to status, not competence. The degree is required only as a legal formality or for its status connotations. The competence it claims to certify is an inessential luxury. This is why, says Deshpande, all the exhortations to improve quality fail in the face of the intractable problem of the quality indifferent customer, whom he sees as armed with substantial purchasing power, but in fact could also be the poor aspirant to education, too. He concludes that this might be an inevitable phase of market and social evolution. So if that is the case, what is the purpose of higher education at this historical moment? And Satish provides us with an answer that is, in a sense, dazzling in its simplicity. I must say I was quite struck by his answer. What is the point of higher education if this is what it's really doing? He says in the social context, in our kind of social context, higher education may be most relevant, not for the training it is supposed to impart, but for the sheer space that it provides. being a legitimate, if embattled, space, it is able to trigger the destabilizing chain of events that, despite the inevitable tragedies along the way, will ultimately bring irreversible change. In other words, he's saying that it's the space. It's not the education that is being provided, but the university as a space that, through a variety of political struggles and inputs through political struggles, informing government policy, the university space has actually expanded, it has massified, it's become huge, and it's become a space of contestation. So I found that, surprisingly, for someone who is part of the university system and can envisage nothing else, no other life, I found it actually peculiarly encouraging to think that this is what the university does. It provides a space for contestation and for inevitable transformation. That may be all that it does, which at one level seems like a very strange thing to say, because that's a lot. But from the point of view of what the university is supposed to do, it may not be doing any of those things. Now, this astute observation brings me to my concluding two sections. I may take another 5 to 7 minutes. It forces us to rethink the education knowledge university nexus as we have taken it for granted, and we are forced to think of it in radically different, even utopian ways. So I look at two alternatives in what follows, two alternatives that have been suggested. It's not so much alternatives to the university, but as alternatives within the university to understanding knowledge, education, and so on. The first intervention here, which I found extremely useful, is that of Boaventura de Souza Santos, who talks about pluriversity as opposed to a university. He states the problem with the university as follows. The university is being confronted by strong questions for which it has only so far provided weak answers. While strong questions go to the roots of the historical identity and the vocation of the university, questioning whether the university as we know it has a future, weak answers take the future of the university for granted, resulting in, he says, immobilism, but also, I think, of sort of great flurry of policy activity. In a later essay, he actually ends up resting a great deal of faith in the Bologna process, which is an EU initiative, which is restructuring European universities. But I feel an earlier essay that he wrote, called The University in the 21st Century, had a much more radical analysis, in which so I'm going to be pretty much paraphrasing Souza Santos here. He says that the public university is under tremendous pressure, due both to the expansion and transnationalization of the market for university services, but also due to the fact that it has lost its hegemony in the past 2 decades as the institution par excellence of knowledge production. And this is because, he says, the relations between knowledge and society have begun to change significantly. The knowledge produced in universities or institutions of the university ethos was, during the 20th century, a predominantly disciplinary knowledge, autonomous in relation to the day-to-day pressures of societies. According to the logic of this process, the researchers are the ones who determine what problems to solve, especially with, he's also talking about science in particular, but this is obviously applicable to social sciences and humanities as well. The researchers are the ones who determine what problems to solve, define their relevance, and establish the methodologies and rhythms of research. It is a homogeneous, hierarchically organized knowledge, insofar as the agents who participate in its production share the same goals of producing knowledge, have the same training and the same culture, scientific, academic culture, and do what they do according to, we do what we do, according to well-defined organizational hierarchies. Moreover, in the logic of this process of the production of university knowledge, the distinction between scientific knowledge and other kinds of knowledge is absolute, as is the relation between science and society. So it's contrary to this, it's counterposing, counterposes what he calls pluriversity knowledge to this university knowledge, which he talks about in this way, that it's a contextual knowledge insofar as the organizing principle of its construction is its application. The initiative for formulating the problems to be solved and the determination of their criteria of relevance is the result of sharing among researchers and users. It is a transdisciplinary knowledge that, by its very contextualization, demands a dialogue or confrontation with other kinds of knowledge, which makes it more heterogeneous internally, allows it to be more adequately produced in less perennial and more open systems, organized less rigidly and hierarchically. All the distinctions upon which university knowledge is based are put in question by pluriversity knowledge, but most basically, it is the relation between science and society that is in question. Society ceases to be an object of scientific questioning and becomes itself a subject that questions science. So he talks about one model of this pluriversity knowledge which has actually been realized in university-industry partnerships. In the form of the kind of knowledge that science departments and industry have engaged in. But he actually thinks that this model can have radical and subversive and extremely productive potential if it is produced in cooperation with and dependent on the solidarity created by partnerships among researchers and labor unions, NGOs, social movements, vulnerable social groups, working class communities, and groups of critical and active citizens. So what he's saying is that there is a growing sector of civil society developing a new and more intense relationship with science and technology, demanding greater participation in their production and in the evaluation of their impact. And in multi-ethnic and multinational countries, he says, pluriversity knowledge begins to emerge. I don't think it begins to emerge. I think it should emerge. I think it has to be actually stated as an agenda for fulfillment, but he says it begins to emerge from inside the university itself when incoming students from ethnic and other minority groups understand that their inclusion is a form of exclusion. So you understand why I'm saying that I don't think it naturally emerges. In fact, they are included. They are included in violent ways so that their inclusion is a form of exclusion, is what he's saying. They learn to become part of the mainstream. The idea of pluriversity is to be taken seriously, they should in fact be able to pose questions back and to talk back to the syllabus and so on. They are confronted with the tabula rasa that is made of their cultures and of the traditional knowledge of their communities. All of this leads scientific knowledge to confront other kinds of knowledge and demand a higher level of social responsibility from the institutions that produce it and consequently from the university. So the university, he says, was created according to a model of unilateral relations with society, and it is this model that underlies its current institutionalism. Pluriversity knowledge supplants this unilateral notion with interactivity, interdependence, both processes enormously invigorated by the technological revolution of information and communication. So in the light of these transformations, he says, we can conclude the university finds itself in the presence of opposing demands. On the one hand is the ultra-private pressure to commodify knowledge, displacing the social responsibility of the university with a focus on producing economically useful and commercially viable knowledge. But on the other hand, there is an ultra-public pressure, which shatters the restricted public sphere of the university in the name of a much broader public sphere traversed by much more heterogeneous confrontations and by much more demanding concepts of social responsibility. This contrast between ultra-private and ultra-public pressures has not only begun to destabilize the university's institutionalism, he says, it has created a profound fracture in the university's social and cultural identity. And he talks about the reconstructing of the university through different forces, including the university community, the state, even certain levels of capital which requires a particular kind of education for itself and so on. So you have these different kinds of social forces that are transforming the university. But he suggests that forces seeking to reconstruct the university through pluriversity must work towards what he calls an ecology of knowledges, in which he suggests a reversal from the extension work that universities sometimes talk about taking up as a very progressive thing to do. The university does extension work in the community outside. So he says, in fact, what is necessary is a counter-extension or an extension in reverse. That is, the university has to absorb and be reshaped by the outside, by the knowledges outside. So this counter-extension or extension in reverse is, I think, a very, very productive idea, so that there are dialogues between lay and popular knowledges, and so on. So that's the Pure University, which does it, which produces this ecology of knowledge is through a counter extension. That is the idea that the university does not condescendingly step out and do a little bit of work in the community, but it allows itself to be. He understands that these are highly fraught, highly tension-ridden, and very contested processes, because even the university community, and everything he says sort of rings a bell for us, because even the university community is deeply fragmented in terms of those who are for neoliberal globalization, or those who think that succumbing to neoliberal globalization may be the only option, as opposed to what he counterposes to it, which is a counter-hegemonic globalization. So he says the only way to avoid surrender is to create conditions for a cooperative university in solidarity with its own global role. The two other, 5 minutes more, two other very interesting initiatives. So the Pluriversity is, I think, more like a manifesto. But two other initiatives that have actually taken off from anarchist, on the basis of anarchist principles in Europe, there's something called the Edufactory Collective. And there's the idea of the common rather than the public university. You can see that these are actually, they're all part of the same field of rethinking the university, the Pluriversity, the ecology of knowledge. You can see similar kinds of aims and objectives in operation. So the Edufactory Collective, for example, claims that its objective is nothing less than to restore the university as a revolutionary political project, building on analysis of the crisis of capitalism. So what it says is that where once the factory was the paradigmatic site of struggle between workers and capitalists, now the university is a key stage of conflict, where the ownership of knowledge, the reproduction of the labor force, and the creation of social and cultural stratifications are at stake. Since knowledge is a key commodity, and the university the site of the production of commodified knowledge, the struggle has to be waged inside, in a so-called knowledge society, the struggle has to be waged inside the university. So the Edufactory statement says, instead of knowledge being produced for the common good within open networks of production, it is being enclosed behind intellectual property laws, student debts, and overall marketization. Alternative forms of knowledge production then become a weapon against austerity. So there is this kind of slogan of against austerity. And militant research is an idea that has emerged as an important one, which is seen as a form of radical political action in which the research object is not a research object, but that research object may well be defined by what you think of as the object. If you're going to study workers, the workers may decide what the research project will be. Now, this is actually really interesting because you can also see echoes of this elsewhere. For example, I shouldn't say echoes of this because these are actually just separate ways in which echoes suggest a kind of primacy to one place. But I think this is the universal, the global mood. And you actually find that students are intervening in spaces where they would not have thought it possible before. If there is one good thing that has come out of the disastrous FIUP and semesterization process in Delhi University, it is the incredible politicization of first-year students. I think all of us who have met and run into these students at meetings and public hearings and so on, the confidence with which they speak about education, what they expect from education, the complete lack of hierarchy with which they speak about university authority and its inability to understand what education should do, I think these are the kinds of things that are actually universities. This is actually pluriversities. These are the ways in which education and the old knowledge education university nexus have been challenged. In JNU, there was a simple routine idea to go in for a JNU press. It was a completely routine. So a committee was routinely set up, of which I was not part. This was set up routinely to look into whether we can have a press. And before you know it, the students were on it. They wanted open access publishing. They wanted the university not to associate with OUP, CUP, and Francis and Taylor. It was incredible. And when it began, when they came to see us, I was like, but this is just a routine thing. It's just a JNU press. What do you want? Why are you getting so upset about it? And this, despite the fact that I'm actually part of the campaign in Delhi University, the legal campaign against the OUP, CUP, Francis and Taylor initiative, it just didn't hit me that this is something that students can speak about, and they are speaking about it. And they've come out with a very, very important document on open access publishing and why JNU, they might be defeated. That's not the point. They have made it as part of the agenda, and they are forced to discuss open access publishing. We should talk about genuine open access publishing as opposed to fake corporate open access publishing through Sage and Francis and Taylor and so on. We'll talk about that if you're interested. But this whole idea that knowledge as open networks of production instead of intellectual property, the common as opposed to the public university, which envisages the linking of universities and social movements, this is, I think, the moment today. So there's an account of an electrifying meeting with which I will conclude at University 8 in Paris in 2011, organized by the Edufactory Collective and the Autonomous Education Network, attended, among others, apparently by student groups from Gambia, Nepal, Poland, Tokyo, Turkey, Canada. And the declaration of it said, which was issued, said, since the state and private interests collaborate in the corporatization process of the university, our struggles will not defend the status quo. We want to make our own university, a university that lives in our experience of autonomous education, alternative research, and free schools. It is a free university run by students, precarious workers, and migrants, a university without borders. And one of the participants in a follow-up conference in Tunis the same year said, this is not science fiction. This is making history.